I had wanted, you know, for a long time to work with Tom Cruise. We had a couple of abortive attempts at working together over the years, but I've known Tom for many, many years, and you know, I've sometimes suggested a project for Tom to do that probably wasn't his exact cup of tea, and a couple of times he's brought things to me.
I remember seeing Jaws, and I'm telling you, when that head came through, you know, the boat underwater, I leapt. I was, you know, over three people standing in the aisle. And I saw E.T. with my family, actually. We were in Jersey. Called my family, said, like, you gotta see this movie. This is gonna be, you know, something you're never gonna forget. So I want it to be a family experience. And just, he's given us so many moments, and in my life, so many moments of real cinema joy that, you know, now you sit across from this guy, and he's really an amazing guy, amazing artist, and also an amazing person. And so, yeah, I wanted to work with him. I think everyone wants to work with Steven, but I had this opportunity, and something that that I really relished and cherished every moment that we were doing it. And you see why he is who he is, and how he deserves all the credit that he gets, and I think even more.
He brought me Minority Report about 3 years ago.
I read the script, sent it over to him, and because I started seeing a lot of great things, you know, in this film. It's always difficult when you're looking for a film, something, finding a unique way to tell a story. I love science fiction.
I'm home.
And I thought it was great. I thought it was really fascinating. So we sent it over to Steven.
And I remember reading the script and liking the idea of the film, especially for Tom.
And he got excited about it, and there we went.
I think what happened was we got into that old development situation where we developed, you know, from the Philip K. Dick original story.
The great thing about Philip Dick is his unconnectedness to the world. He never felt that he was a part of the same world that you and I are a part of. And this has to do with a lot of reasons. He came from a troubled background. He had actual physical problems. He had psychological problems. There's a great lore of Philip Dick's troubled history. And my personal connection to him and what sort of drew me into this story or into Philip K. Dick's life and vision is he's uncertain of the world, he's paranoid about the world, which real is real and so forth. And one of the themes of Minority Report, the short story, is about seeing, looking into the future. And for me, that was the great insight into how to shape the story into a script. In the story, there's not a lot of world to work with. He doesn't have a lot of gadgets. He doesn't really tell you what his themes are. You don't have a real sense of what the future world looks like. But as soon as I began thinking about the precognitives, I found my theme for the way that I wanted to go at the story, which was sight. Eyes. What do you see? What does the hero see? What do the precogs see?
As a writer, I'm very much influenced by those films of the 70s and the 60s, the thrillers that we were doing, because we used to make genre movies for grown-ups. And we don't do that so much anymore. Thrillers are now usually just sort of action movies, and again, they're more conceptual and just sort of not about character. They're people more with attitudes than they are real characters. And we really tried to make a conscious effort to have the people be in this as much as we could, be as real as they could be.
I was coming in and out because I was busy making other movies at the time. And eventually, I read a script that I liked enough to call Tom and say, yeah, I'll do this version with you.
All right, Howard Marks, where are you?
The opening of the film is sort of in an old Georgetown setting, and bit by bit you see these little specks, and then boom, you're inside the temple, and you're like, okay, totally different world.
It's okay. It's okay. This is Daniel.
But the film's based in Washington, D.C., and they're doing sort of this test case, pre-crime is, of having these three psychic beings predict murders that are about to happen. give you the name of the murderer, the name of the person that they're going to kill.
I think all of us would love to know what's just around the corner. We'd all love to know what's going to happen next in the world, in our lives. And it's just kind of a need to know about the unknowable. And I think this story flirts with what if we had the chance to know certain things about the future, especially things that come under the heading of life and death.
Where's my minority report?
Minority report simply means if three precogs agree that someone is guilty and will commit that crime in the future, then that crime will occur. But if one of the precogs dissents and casts a dissenting vote, then it can't be a perfect system, and there must be something wrong with it.
Chad, are you getting this? It's a single stream from the female only with no time or incident data. Whatever this is, it isn't the future.
And something so wrong that the system would not be allowed to exist in our nation.
You can't do a movie like this without at least acknowledging what the debate would be around it.
Under arrest for the future murder of Sarah Marks and Donald Dubin. It was take place today, April 22nd, at 0800 hours, 4 minutes.
No, I didn't do anything.
Once Sarah, you come and arrest me and tell me that tomorrow at 3 o'clock I'm going to kill someone, I haven't done it yet. So am I truly a murderer yet? Just because I've thought of it, does that mean I'm going to actually do it?
We are arresting individuals who have broken no law.
But they will. The commission of the crime itself is absolute metaphysics. The precogs see the future and they're never wrong.
But it's not the future.
The explanation of why it works is that the precogs are never wrong, period. And Anderton takes one of the spheres that the perps' names are engraved on and he tosses it across the table, and our sort of competitor to Anderton's character named Danny Whitwer catches the ball before it hits the ground.
You caught it. The fact that you prevent it from happening doesn't change the fact that it was going to happen.
Well, that's exactly why we know pre-crime works.
If there was a system in place that was infallible, that was basically blessed by the Supreme Court of the United States and voted on in a national referendum by the people of this country, that allows you to, you know, change the Bill of Rights to simply stop a murder from happening. And if there was never a flaw in the system, I would be in favor of that.
After all, who wants a justice system that instills doubt? It may be reasonable, but it's still doubt.
Although it does save a lot of lives, there is that question as well, what about the 0.002% that possibly would have changed their mind, could have changed their mind?
None of us would ever want to see that happen and change the rights that we have fought and died for in this country.
But what about those people that I put away with alternate futures? Oh my God, if the country knew there was a chance.
The system would collapse.
It's a little frightening in some ways to think that it could become a reality, to even think that there might be a so-called thought police that feels that they're putting themselves in a position to second guess what people might be doing.
Positive for Howard Marks.
But I look at it as an A thriller. When I think about Hitchcock thrillers, I think about some of the great thrillers of yesterday. This is right up there with the best of them.
Goodbye.
Dude, wait!
The best science fiction is based sort of on the fact or even on future facts, and then the imagination gets to springboard from the sort of the facts of the past, the facts of the present, and the facts of the future. And so based on that, I think there's some credibility to the story that we're trying to tell here.
Someone intends to kill his boss or his wife, but they never go through with it. How do the precogs tell the difference?
Precogs don't see what you intend to do. Only what you will do. It's a terrific character to play because it's a guy who you think he's basically at the top of his game as a pre-crime cop, and they think he's going to commit a crime, so they start chasing after him, which is always a great way to have a story where a guy's on the run.
He set me up, just wait. He set me up. Whitworth, it's
now, Whitworth. He has to discover, is there a flaw in the system? Or is he really going to kill this person he's never heard of before? And is the flaw, in fact, within himself. And that was really what compelled me to want to direct Tom Cruise in this story.
I didn't really do any preparation for it as such because I don't know really anything about being a federal agent, and I didn't have to know that much legalistic jargon or anything like that, so it was just about coming in, I think, in a lot of the scenes with a certain attitude and with a certain confidence that this character has in himself and in his knowledge. The first day I arrived, one of the first things I did was with Cruz and him behind the monitor, and I completely forgot that some stage in that day, I was going to have to look into Tom Cruise's eyes while Steven Spielberg shouted action. I nearly died and I had a meltdown, and I did many takes. But he's just so open, and he seems to see the world while being very incredibly smart through a child's eyes.
Oh no, please, don't put me in a danger.
You know, and he gets so excited about ideas, and even if it's one of my ideas and it's mediocre at best, he's like, oh yeah, that's good, try that.
Okay, good, here we go.
I find you just want to do the best job you can for him.
Action.
Well, then why can't they see rapes, or assaults, or suicides? Because of the nature of murder.
Good, we got it. Thank you. Next shot. Great.
Yeah, reload.
Good.
John, watch this Danny Whitaker, the observer from Justice.
Max von Sydow's our father figure in the story, almost like a surrogate father of Tom Cruise's character.
Much. But would Hinneman know?
Come in.
Security lockdown enabled.
Just tell me, who's Leo Klon?
Cut. Beautiful. Beautiful. Good take. Both of you.
There are directors who give orders, who tell the actors what to do. Most actors hate that. At least I do. I want to keep at least some of the initiative. Steven Spielberg belongs to the opposite side. He suggests, he inspires, and leads the actors without the actors really knowing. And he knows the world of the film he is directing so well that he also can improvise, which is wonderful.
With pre-crime going national, maybe we can all look forward to a time when none of us will have to discharge another firearm ever again.
He can improvise within a take and pick up things. Maybe things happen within the take which are not really planned, and he uses it. And he knows also very, very well the language of the camera, the language of film, better than anybody.
We have three precogs. Their names are Agatha, Dashiell, and Arthur. Arthur Conan Doyle, Dashiell Hammett, and Agatha Christie, named after them. And those are the names that the government gave these little children who are now in their 20s, but were much younger when the government found out that they possessed, working together, this enormous gift and used them to fight crime. Samantha Morton plays the precog, Agatha.
She's a child, she's like a newborn baby, but she also has a wisdom far, far beyond her years. She's an oracle. So she sees everything that everyone else sees. She sees people's feelings. She feels people's feelings and emotions. She feels people's pain and suffering. She sees pain and suffering. On the first day, I arrived and we had a talk. We'd spoken before anyway, but it was kind of, he wanted to give me the freedom to show him where my head was at. And he was really happy with what I did. And then from then on, we just communicated about each moment and what it meant.
John, what the hell just happened?
Acting in the water, it was the hardest thing I've ever done, ever. Because it's kind of, you're dealing with another element that you're not used to as an actor. Even if you've been acting 30 years, you know, stage, radio, movies, TV, nothing prepares you for acting like underwater or in water. And having to be that intense and safety, and it's hard, but you feel a sense of achievement when you've done it. But I'm really glad to be out of that tank. I really am.
Samantha Morton, who plays the female precog, she's got this angelic quality in her. She's kind of an angel. So subsequently, I wanted to reflect that character through lighting. And that's very noticeable in the final scene when we are at the Chesapeake Bay, when we are at the country home, right before Tom is being arrested. During the scene, Samantha tells the story of his son's future. It's a very, very moving sequence. It's a sequence that allowed stomach closure. Her face is kind of bright, kind of burned out. It's almost unreal.
There was so much love in this house.
I wanted back so bad.
It's all my fault.
There was nothing anyone could do.
Catherine Morris, I saw in Rod Lurie's film, The Contender. I asked her to play Tom Cruise's estranged wife in Minority Report, and she provides a lot of heart and soul.
You and John ever come here?
He used to, every summer.
He's not here now, is he?
Laura is at a point in her life where they've been separated for several years. They're divorced, John Anderton and Laura Anderton, things have been so terrible.
It was nobody's fault.
But when we see Laura, I think she's in a more more introverted place. I think a protection place, trying to huddle and recover and trying to do something productive with her life to hang on.
You lose your son, let's see how well you handle it.
So I feel so honored that I get to play this woman who's so well-rounded and so strong and so multidimensional, has so many layers, and with all these great actors and the man, Stephen.
I'd like a word with my husband.
It's a very interesting and hard kind of movie to make because on the one hand, there's a lot of story, there's a lot of mystery, there's a lot of clues. You must pay attention when you watch the movie. At the same time, Anderton is going through a huge human emotional struggle.
It reminds me of Rosarito Beach. Remember?
It's always fun to have things like that where you have a transformation.
The future is so much more interesting than the past, don't you think?
You know, we have the scene where Michelle Burke, who's a makeup artist, came up with a terrific disguise to get back into pre-crime.
Who are you?
I like you, Wally.
Hi, John.
Then we had, in the picture also, I wear brown contacts. I lose my eyes halfway through the film. So I have someone else's eyes in the picture.
Hello, Mr. Yakamoto. Welcome back to the Gap.
Mr. Yakamoto.
I wanted this to be a very human story. There's a lot of different mysteries in our story, but they're all about people. And you meet very colorful characters along the way. And I think Minority Report has a bit of a brotherhood with some of the John Huston film noir mystery stories, because we do meet some of the most compelling characters in the story aren't necessarily the leads of our story. They're the characters that provide information to follow leads and prove innocence or prove guilt.
You're blind.
There's very interesting characters that you tiptoe through in trying to unscramble the mystery and trying to figure out the story.
You dig up the past, all you get is dirty.
I'm not gonna get haloed.
You can't run, John.
Everybody runs.
I've done a few pictures, and when they're set up properly, and we have a great team, the same guys that did MI2, and so they know physically what I'm capable of, and they just go in and set it up, and we talk about it, and they kind of bring it over, and we run through it a bit and make some adjustments, and then I'm ready to go.
Keith Campbell has been with him for, I think, 10 years. Tom trusts him totally, and what Keith does is work out all the problems. And when Tom comes to the stunt, Keith will explain exactly. You need to put your right foot here, and here's why. You need to move this hand here and grab this because this is happening. You know, he'll go through every little detail of how to shift his body weight and how to move his feet to accomplish the stunt safely. And Tom listens very intently, and so he picks up really fast. In this particular case, it was very controlled because the cars really weren't moving. The harder part is Tom has to react as if it was, as losing his balance, and when he's climbing, you have to take in all those elements that aren't really there. You have a wind machine, yes, but it's not quite the same as the real sensation of falling. So we try to choreograph in the real sensations as we're doing it. He's really good at that kind of stuff, so it makes my job easy that he's so in tune with how his body would react.
He's extremely athletic and he's not afraid of anything. I've got him to think more like a stuntman in that it takes only a very small thing and the human body gets hurt very easily. And so when you're doing these big stunts that he likes to do himself, it's very important to take it in slow steps. And he has finally on this movie gotten for me where he's in sync, where he is big on the rehearsals and he's always listened very well. He's always been very athletic.
Oh. Glenn, can you...
I get it.
It's extremely unusual, but again, he's really good at it, and it does help the movie tremendously, I think, to see that it's him doing it.
Stephen wanted to do a very elaborate, three-dimensional flying chase where cops wearing flying jackets would be chasing Tom down the alley. So we started off looking at locations and it very quickly realized that it was completely impractical to do any of the rigging involved in a real location or even the lighting really. So we went to a backlot at Warner Brothers and really just built an alley that was similar to something in downtown. It wasn't a direct match, but it allowed the grips to build 30 feet above our rig, the most incredible flying stunt rig.
We had to put up basically our own stage, if you will, in order to travel people up and down the alley. So miles upon miles of truss and wire was put in the whole length of the alley so that we could travel 6 to 8 people at different speeds, different heights, along with the camera, up and down, dragging on the ground, pulling straight up, falling straight down. And that's one of the more difficult sequences.
My immediate reaction was, how am I going to do this?
Fast free fall, they stop right above the car, right like
In
that.
The end, we pulled it off, but it was very difficult.
Ready, drop! Great!
All the high falls where he jumped off the building and grabbed one of the pre-crime cops that was coming to arrest him, that was all Tom. He did all those high jumps.
Yes, there was wire removal. Yes, there was an enhancement on that jetpacks. We were putting the flame. But pretty much what you see happen in real life. Those actors are actually descending down from like 90 feet on specially designed rigs.
My number one priority from the very start is safety. That's the first thing I have to deal with. What's very difficult in that situation is anytime someone's flying in this scene, they're on a cable. And anytime someone's on a cable, there's people, it takes a lot of people. Just to make one guy travel through the air, fly up and down, it takes 2 to 3 people. So we had 6 people in the air all the time. It's a real challenge to get that many people to move where they're supposed to move and not look like they're hanging on wires.
Well, I think we're going out to the car factory tomorrow to have a look at the location and see where it's going to work out geographically and where we're going to go.
Every movie has the scene that will the most time will be spent on. On this film, I would say that it was definitely the car factory. And it involves intensely every single department. Michael Lantieri is involved, props are involved, ILM is involved, you know, our art department's involved, stunts are involved intensely. Tom, therefore, is involved. And not only Tom, but a scene that's probably going to involve 6 to 7 other actors and stuntmen.
I worked with Tom's stunt double Keith as well, just so I don't break Tom's nose or he doesn't break mine. Just on missed punches and body shots and all that kind of stuff.
Tom again is being chased and they meet up him within in a car factory, which has thousands of robotic arms that are building this car. So I have to work with, we use real robots actually to do some of the lifting and fighting and transfers of the onto a crane that was actually at the factory where we're filming. And that combined with a lot of special effects elements, and we end up with a hopefully real looking scene. I crave the newness of and trying to push the envelope of it and keep in the realm of safety. So, and yeah, I do think what we did on this film, we've gone further as far as people flying than has been done, I hope, anyway, in the end, that we've created something that's visually different than has been done before. But I definitely always, always, always am striving for that anyway.
Stunts help tell the story. It's science fiction, so you're in the future, so you can have some cool stunts, and it was that stuff was a lot of fun. They're tricky, but they're a lot of fun.
I still love set construction. I love set design. Alex McDowell did an amazing job designing the production of Minority Report, and he had done the Fight Club, you know, prior to that, and had developed, although the film wasn't made, for Mel Gibson, all the whole look of Fahrenheit 451 when Mel was going to remake it. And I hired him more based on those sketches, and Alex came in and built all these sets. He built all of Pre-Crime.
These sets are extremely beautiful, very, very contemporary, very sensual, with curves, you know, and straight lines, with lots of glass and metallic surfaces, which I personally really like. I like when the material used in the set building technique has metallic surface, because subsequently the light is reflected really beautifully. And if the set has glass, you get reflections, but also you can see through the glass what's on the other side of the glass. So you get this layering. And that's what the world of Minority Report happens to be. It's very densely layered.
We looked at a lot of modern architecture. We looked at a lot of really contemporary into future architecture. We looked at the architects who are pushing the envelope right now. We also, really from an impetus from Stephen, the idea that Pre-Crime was a kind of a transparent organization, that it had nothing to hide, that there was something psychologically about the fact that there was no kind of hidden secret, and at the same time it's hiding like the biggest secret of all.
Alex designed a really wonderful symbol, the Pre-Crime badge, that when you actually see the chamber where the precogs are floating in this kind of solution, when you look at it from straight down, it is in the same shape as the precog symbol. And yet the public does not know what the precogs look like. The precogs were never interviewed on national television. They are the greatest kept secret in Washington, D.C.
Can we see the precogs?
Well, the precogs have such a powerful gift that they have to be kept in peaceful seclusion so as not to be distracted from the outside world.
There's more of a mythology about them that they have represented in a statue, a kind of modern art sculpt. That's about 75 feet tall, that's just outside of the Pre-Crime headquarters in Washington, D.C.
We had our own sculptors developing this, and we took the idea that they were coming out of the liquid, that the base is the shape of the tank in which they float. So we used that element, and then we drew them up out of that as if they had come risen up out of liquid. But I think that we've achieved, or the sculptors have achieved, something that's very close to a piece of art in the real world. I think it's not derived really from anything except its own intent.
Don't cry.
We thought of the precog chamber as being the center of Pre-Crime. From talking to the scientists, developed a slightly spurious kind of scientific theory that the milk in which they're immersed helps the transmission of thoughts that they're receiving from the outside world and being held by the milk. Essentially.
The photon milk acts as both a nutrient supply and a liquid conductor. It enhances the images that each of them receive.
And we thought that this had to be a very womb-like space. And what we imagined was a kind of acoustic chamber where the surface of the chamber reflected in some way that their brains would be working.
Right now we're sitting in the egg, we call it. The three precog visionaries lay on cradles inside the tub that you see in this set. The tricky thing is Stephen wanted the water that they're in to be a little thick, the temperature to be comfortable for them, and there is a scene in the movie where 5,000 gallons of water has to empty in 2.5 seconds. So there's some science involved to it, and we wanted to do it all practical. So it's quite a ride. The rest of the issues is just maintaining the water level, maintaining the clarity of the water for photography, maintaining the safeness of the water, the toxicity of the water, the filtering of the water, the heating of the water. All that goes into the mechanical effects department that just kind of goes unseen in movies.
I missed you so much.
It's okay, Wally's here.
Designing for the precogs. That was actually the hardest thing in the whole movie to do for me. It started out very complicated, very high tech, and it went through maybe about 10 different designs before we settled on what finally was really right for me and for Stephen, was the simplicity of what they wear. Initially, we started with the second skin idea, and then we sort of took off from there and had to come back to it. And ultimately, it was really about simply presenting a second skin for these people that it's almost more like a embryonic kind of covering, and selecting a fabric that really reflected in the water that was very amphibian-like. For the pre-crime cops, I kind of harkened back to what I called, you know, the image of the right stuff. You know, Air Force pilots and astronauts and things like that. And then just sort of interpreted it in our kind of steely gray, futuristic mode.
I just thought it was important for Deborah Scott to understand that the costumes couldn't be Buck Rogers, they couldn't be Flash Gordon, they couldn't be out of things to come. You know, they had to be close to how we look at wardrobe and clothing today.
When I started the film, I kind of had, my first impulse was sort of an anti-design. I didn't want it to look like something that would be, you know, you'd look at in 5 years and think was terribly outdated. I haven't done that many science fiction projects myself, so it was a real challenge. And then you, on the other hand, you have this great opportunity to sort of do whatever you want. You know, you can make it up. You're sort of creating this whole world. You don't want it to look silly.
Fire them up!
In the think tank, we talked about what kind of weapons would future cops have, and they came up with a couple of cool weapons.
And it started with our work at MIT and what some of their students and graduate students are really developing, and what some of our military resources are really developing, which is in the line of non-lethal weapons.
One weapon that the think tank came up with, which was basically a sonic gun, it creates a sonic boom, and it messes with the sound waves in the air. You know, rendering that subject completely unconscious. There was another idea that somebody came up with for something called a sick stick, which is just like a simple baton, a police baton, but instead of hitting somebody over the head with it, you just have to touch them anywhere in their body, and they vomit. So, rather than having bullets being shot from guns, we do have bullets in this movie that are shot from guns, the old-fashioned weapons, but all the newfangled weapons the cops use really came from this think tank.
Help yourself.
The hover packs were also just a product of, I just love the old serials like Commando Cody, you know, and I remember he used to run and jump and adjust a rather large knob on his breastplate, which allowed him to go forward or land. I think one said up and one arrow said down, and I thought, well, maybe the police would actually be flying around in jetpacks. At the 84 Olympics in Los Angeles, I saw a jetpack land in the center of the LA Coliseum at the beginning of the opening day ceremonies. And I never forgot that image and how loud it was. Our jetpacks are much quieter because they've perfected that. And there's police lights, the blue, red, and white flashing strobe lights on both sides of the backpack. So in a sense, the cops themselves are their own police cars.
And I'm placing you under arrest.
Go to sleep.